Congressman Adam Schiff of California. He's a Democrat, the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee. Congressman, thanks very much for joining us.
You bet.
What's your advice to the White House, to the President, the Justice Department right now, what to do about the travel ban?
I think they should scrap it. I think it was an ill-conceived idea. If they want to explore any further vetting that should be put in place, they should do that, but they shouldn't essentially say we're going to ban immigration from these Muslim countries. It sends exactly the wrong message. It plays into al-Qaeda and ISIS narrative, and it alienates a lot of our allies in the region. Our work in Iraq in particular just got a lot more difficult.
What about Michael Flynn, the president's national security advisor? Should he go?
He should go. He should go. You know, we certainly need to get to the bottom of just what he discussed with the Russian ambassador. But his explanation now that he doesn't remember whether he talked about sanctions just is incredible. And bear in mind, this is a guy who relentlessly and unjustifiably attacked Susan Rice, claiming that she misled the country. And now it looks like he's been misleading the country on an issue of signal importance.
Is there hard intelligence, hard information confirming that he lied to the Vice President, Mike Pence, by denying that the subject of sanctions in that phone call with the Russian Ambassador Kislyak ever came up?
I don't know the answer yet. It's something I think the Intelligence Committee ought to be investigating as part of its investigation into Russian covert influence. But I think the reason that Flynn is in such trouble right now and the reason why the Trump administration just doesn't label this as fake news is they know that if there is a transcript, if there are recordings, that can't be dismissed. That's why I think they have to take this seriously. But frankly, the policy is enormously wrongheaded of easing sanctions on Russia. But the fact that they would mislead the country about this is inexplicable.
Isn't it routine, though, that the U.S. Would monitor phone conversations, especially on open lines, that a Russian ambassador or high-ranking Russian official might have with an American?
You know, that's not something I can comment on, but I think prudently, if I were an American in Russia, I would certainly assume that they were listening in on any of my conversations. And obviously, we have a keen interest in what the Russians are discussing. What I think is interesting here, there are allegations, again, as yet unproven, that they may have also used encrypted communications. Since Flynn was talking with the Russians, if he was using encrypted communications, it wasn't to conceal it from the Russians. And you have to ask, who were they concealing the conversation
from? This is an important element. Explain what you mean that when he made that call, and apparently there were several phone calls to the Russian ambassador here in Washington, he was part of the transition team. He was a top national security advisor to the then president-elect. What kind of encrypted communications would they be? U.S. government-approved encrypted communications?
Well, you know, some have alleged that there were, in addition to phone calls, there were encrypted communications. This is something I think we need to determine as part of investigation. But if there were, then the question is, why were those being used? Who were those conversations to be concealed from? Why was it necessary to go to that if you were talking about simply Christmas greetings, as Sean Spicer apparently misrepresented to the country?
Are you worried? I mean, there's been some concern out there forget about the one phone conversation that Michael Flynn may have had with the Russian ambassador and then misleading the vice president and other officials, including the White House chief of staff, Reince Priebus, press secretary Sean Spicer. Forget about that. But that there's a broader problem involving Michael Flynn's connection with Russia?
This is the most serious allegation that was made in these articles, and that is that the December 29th communication between Flynn and the Russian ambassador wasn't a one-off, that it was a part of a long series of communications that took place during the campaign. Now, that's foursquare within the investigations that we need to be doing on the intelligence committees, but that would mean the potential of collusion. Here you have the Russians hacking, conducting illegal covert operations in the United States. If there was any kind of cooperation, collaboration with the Trump campaign, that would violate numerous laws and be far more significant than any potential violation of the Logan Act.
I've covered U.S.-Russian relations for a long time. It used to be the Soviet Union. I don't remember ever, and we can go back and triple check, a time when the U.S. imposes some sanctions against Russia, expelling 35 diplomats, and then all of a sudden the Russians say, you know what, we're not going to respond in kind, because almost always throughout that long history, especially during the Cold War, the U.S. does something, the Russians do exactly the opposite in return. And the question is being asked, did Flynn say something to the Russian ambassador that eventually got up to Putin to say, you know what, we're not going to expel American diplomats, for example, in retaliation?
This is why that call is so suspicious, taking place on the day that sanctions are announced. The very uncharacteristic, indeed probably unprecedented, Russian unwillingness to respond in any way. It certainly is suggestive of a conversation that sent a signal to Moscow and to the Kremlin, don't react to this, we'll take care of this. And again, the context is, this is right after an election in which the Russians helped Donald Trump. Sanctions were imposed as a punishment for that, and here you have the chief national security proxy for Trump potentially telling the Russians, we'll take care of it.
And it was very curious because the Putin decision not to expel American diplomats and impose sanctions in return followed a public statement by the Russian foreign minister saying the Russians would respond directly with sanctions of its own and expulsions of its own. So it was very, very curious, all of that, and I'm sure they're looking closely to see if there was a Michael Flynn role in that decision, any of that down the road.
Absolutely.
Very serious allegations. Very quickly before I let you go, you agree with Director Woolsey, North Korea right now is the top national security threat facing the U.S.?
You know, I'm not sure whether it's North Korea or Iran, probably on any given day. It seems like either would qualify. But I do think that the North Korea is more likely to have the serious flashpoint, because if they get to the point where they can put miniaturized nuclear weapons on an intercontinental ballistic missile, then you are at a decision point, and that's a very tough decision. I think with the Iran nuclear deal, we've put off any kind of confrontation like that at least for over a decade. So I think perhaps the more immediate threat in terms of nuclear weapons comes from North Korea. The more proximate terrorism threat comes from Iran.
You're assuming the Iranians honor the nuclear deal. Then it would be put off for at least for a decade. But there are a lot of people who are wondering, will the Iranians continue?
Well,
so far, they're honoring it.
We're
but let's see what
watching
happens.
Them like a hawk.
I'm sure you are. I'm sure the U.S. intelligence community is. I'm sure the Trump administration is as well. Congressman, thanks for joining.